lounging, and she owed exactly what he's talking about. She literally died.
Usually,
did you see that with people like
so
on drugs or something?
I'm sorry.
Like who were taking drugs or something? Did you see people who like drink too much water?
Yeah, that mental.
Yeah.
Some people just obsess with the water. They get obsessed with it because their altered mental state or they have some obsession. You know, so some people drink too much water. And you can hurt yourself. Just, that proves the point. Did he win the Xbox?
Like, my grandmother was in the hospital because she drank too much water, and it was because she wasn't eating enough protein. So because of not enough protein plus drinking too much water, it made her albumin go like way up, and it was like,
there you go.
That's a great
example.
Was, like,
thank you for both those. That's a great example.
You put that down.
I can't believe that. That's true. That's sad.
I think it was because it was so shocking, because nobody ever thinks that you can drink too much water.
Yeah.
Too much of anything.
Any of these people that drink, when they eat so many hot dogs or something like that, and someone chokes, and it's like...
Stupid.
Oh, temperature. More than 1 degree warmer than body temperature. So blood is warm. Oh, we did mention that. It helps keep our body, so it's warm. It's about 100.4 degrees Fahrenheit. Some repetition here. Viscosity, it's dead, just said that. It's thicker, it's 5 times thicker than water. Osmolarity, I said, refers to the albumin, right? So, high osmolarity, increased blood volume, which increases blood pressure.
Yes.
Why? Think about what we just talked about. Get mentally wrapped around this and understand it. If you have too much, osmolarity refers to the albumin. So it's high in the bloodstream. You have all that force bringing fluid into the, drawing fluid into the blood vessel. You have a closed container, blood vessel. Now you're putting more fluid in it. That's going to increase the pressure on the walls of that fluid, of that vessel, of the blood vessel. More fluid in that blood vessel means it's pushing harder against the walls. That's potentially dangerous. High blood pressure can break those walls, can cause damage to those walls. Now you have an aneurysm possibility, or a dissection possibility, a ripping of that artery. So high osmolarity leads to increased blood pressure. Low osmolarity, too little of albumin, leads to what we just talked about. Fluid goes into the body tissues and causes edema. So we're saying here what I already mentioned. So that is a problem of malnutrition, low albumin, low osmolarity, fluid going into the tissues. And it's called kwashiorkor. Hypo, low, hyper is high, hypo, low protein. Deficiency of protein in the blood that causes that fluid to leak out of the formed elements make up about 45% of the blood volume, again, repetition. Mainly red blood cells, we know that. It's the packed stuff after you spin it down called the hematocrit, we know that. The red blood cell is the most common cell in the body, 25 trillion. So you think, okay, so those cells must die. They're going somewhere. We can't keep making blood cells and they don't go anywhere. We have no room in our bodies anymore. There's 25 trillion. So Yes, and when they get to where they go, when they die. Less than 1% is white blood cells. Hemo or hematopoiesis. Poiesis is a suffix that means production. So we're talking about the production of these blood cells. Hemopoiesis or hemato, both are correct. Formed elements have a short lifespan, so new ones are constantly being made. All begin, we mean all, we mean all blood cells begin in the bone marrow from a stem cell called a hemocytoblast. Blast is a suffix that means a very immature blood cell.
It's like the osteoblast.
Osteoblast, correct. They can develop into many different types of cells. They all begin in the bone marrow. And that's a hemocytoblast. I don't care if you're talking about red blood cell and all the different types of white blood cells. Two different lines, in other words, two pathways in regards to development. So they all begin in bone marrow, but there's two ways they develop, two different ways they develop. Myeloid means in the bone marrow, so development is in the bone marrow, and this is red blood cells, platelets, and four of the five types of white blood cells. So we're talking about the production of these blood cells. We say they all come from the same hemocytoblast in the bone marrow, every one of them. And some of them, a lot of them, stay in the bone marrow and grow up. They mature, they develop. And so red blood cells do, platelets do, and four out of the five white blood cells, the only one that doesn't is the lymphocyte. That doesn't mature in the bone marrow. These all mature in the bone marrow. So they're born there and they stay there and grow up. Lymphocyte is born there, but doesn't stay there and grow up. Lymphoid produces the different types of lymphocytes. And where does this occur? Where does the growing up of lymphocytes occur? Lymph tissue like thymus, lymph nodes, tonsils, and spleen. I remember when I first heard this, it's like, oh, okay. So that's what a tonsil is. I don't know what the heck a tonsil is. Okay, yeah. It's a lymphoid tissue that helps produce lymphocytes.
Why would you have your tonsils removed?
Well, you've got other things that will kick in. If they're causing a problem, you can spare those. You can actually spare the spleen, too. You can live without a spleen as well. So, just to bring up a little thing about lymph nodes. Remember I said it's part of that secondary circulation system, the lymph system? It picks up the leftover fluid and thus can pick up bacteria if there's an infection or cancer cells. Cancer cells will go into the lymph system, and that's one way it can be spread through the lymph system. And they'll get caught up in those filters, the lymph nodes. And that's why if you have breast cancer, you look at the axillary lymph nodes. And if they're involved, they gotta go too. And if a lot of them are involved, that's not good. That means it's spread. So that's when you hear about lymph nodes. You know, breast cancer, how many nodes were involved? Was there node involvement? Or, you know, that's why they're saying that's that lymphatic system. So, these lymph nodes are also where these lymphocytes mature and grow up. All the elements have their origin in the red bone marrow, but not all the development occurs in the marrow. All of the elements came from the same stem cell, hemocytoblast, but we see that the lymphocyte matured outside the bone marrow.
So it's not the produced, it's like mature, right?
It matures there, but it's producing mature lymphocytes. So the baby ones go there, and the adults are produced there. The adults' lymphocytes are produced there. That is confusing. I agree with you. Thanks for pointing that out. So they're all born in bone marrow. Most of them mature in bone marrow. Lymphoid tissue is where lymphocytes mature. That's where the adult lymphocytes come from. So yeah, I would put something so you understand that the lymphocyte is born in the bone marrow, it grows up in the lymphoid tissue. Yeah, I agree, that's confusing. Thank you. Confuse you by putting my clinical stuff in there a little bit?
No, I think it helps.
Hematopoiesis, blood cell production. Adult produces 400 billion platelets, 200 billion RBCs, and 10 billion white blood cells every single day, and 3 million RBCs every second. We're pumping it out. Hemopoietic tissues produce blood cells. Liver stops producing blood cells at birth. Spleen remains involved with white blood cell production. But it's not the only thing it does, so you can live without that. Okay, let's go for 10 more minutes. We can go to 8 o'clock. He's hanging there. That's a lot of stuff. Erythrocytes, red blood cells. Remember, erythro is red. Disc-shaped cell with a thick rim. And you can see the shape of it. Disc-shaped with a thick rim. Form follows function. Red blood cells look like this because of what they need to do. And so this makes them very efficient, shaped like this. Able to stack up, like plates on top of each other, able to stack up and line up to go through small blood vessels and capillaries. So they're shaped so that they can be stacked. And one by one, in single file, go through these little narrow tunnels that they have to. They are also made up of these cytoskeletal proteins that allow them to flex and to bend and squeeze around corners and get through small openings. They're designed that way because they need to get through small openings. Blood type is determined by surface proteins called antigens. So key point, we're gonna talk about this more, but key point right now is that the blood types, type A, type B, type AB, type O, are determined by antigens, not antibodies. Antibodies are what we form because of the antigens. It's the antigens that makes you, it's your antigens that make you type A, and you type B, and you type O. Key, circle that, underline that. It's the antigens that make our blood types. Yes?
And that's not like hereditary, right? That's just based on like individuals with blood types? Or is it? Okay.
Well, unless you're talking about RH, which we'll talk about.
Okay.
Yeah. RBCs, specifically the antigens on RBCs, determine the blood type. So it's not the white blood cells that determine the blood type, it's the red blood cells, and specifically the antigens. RBCs change shape so that they can fit through the small blood vessels called capillaries. They can change shape due to proteins called spectrin and actin. Actin should sound familiar. Mm-hmm. I hope it gives you a little nightmare, but actin and myosin and sarcomere. So this biconcave shape of RBC increases the surface area so it can carry more oxygen and carbon dioxide. This shape down there helps it to stack and get through small places. The spectrin and actin allow the flex to get around corners and through spaces. Plus, its shape allows it to hold more oxygen and more carbon dioxide. It makes it more efficient. If it was shaped differently like this, it wouldn't be as efficient. This is the best shape. Exactly. We'll get to that, but thank you, that's exactly right. Sickle cell is a disease where it's not shaped like that, and so it's inefficient. Form follows function. That's the best way a blood cell can work, right, like that. It's a function of best. Anything else is less than efficient. RBCs almost devoid of internal structures. Form follows function. We want that RBC to be really, really good at carrying as much oxygen and as much carbon dioxide as possible. So let's not put stuff in there that doesn't need to be in there. This cell doesn't need all the ribosomes and mitochondria and all this stuff. Doesn't need it. We want this to be efficient. No. In fact, sentence three, RBCs do not have a nucleus. Therefore, no DNA, no mitochondria. In fact, really, by definition, it's not even a cell. It doesn't have a nucleus. It's a container. It's an empty container, which is exactly what you need. RBCs rely on anaerobic fermentation to produce energy. Huh? What if they had oxygen in it? Can they just use the oxygen? No, your cells need the oxygen. That's like you being a truck driver and delivering ice cream and you eat it all before it gets there, you know? That's not good for the people that want ice cream. So it is relying on non-oxygen energy production. It doesn't want to use what it has to transport. Are the only cell in the body to solely, completely, 100% rely on anaerobic fermentation. It never, you know, our muscles go back and forth, right? We said that with sprinting, our thigh muscles. Sprinting is non-oxygen, but when you start a marathon running, we get into oxygen. These cells don't do that. These cells never use oxygen. They never use what they're transporting. 33% of red blood cell is that chemical called hemoglobin, which is what the oxygen directly attaches to. So you think of the red blood cell as a container, and in it is the hemoglobin that will hold the oxygen. And each hemoglobin molecule holds four oxygen molecules. 1-4 ratio. One hemoglobin equals four oxygen. Gas transport, major function, carries over 98% of the oxygen and 23% of the carbon dioxide. 33% of RBC the internal structure of an RBC is hemoglobin. It also produces a chemical called carbonic anhydrase, which can actually be measured in the blood. Carbonic anhydrase, CAH. It produces carbonic acid from carbon dioxide and water, and this carbonic anhydrase enzyme is important in the role of gas transport and pH balance. It buffers the blood. So the only thing you really need to remember here, carbonic anhydrase, is that it is important in the transport of gas and pH balance. I guess perfect time to stop. Okay. Have a great weekend. Any questions? Anything? Good job.